like to explore the question, what does it take to apply mindfulness not only to the individual, but to the level of the collective, to the level of the whole system, to the level of the social field? And if mindfulness is the capacity to paying attention to our attention, and if that capacity can be strengthened by placing our attention on an object that we choose, like our breathing or the feeling of our body, or a mantra, or any kind of object, then my question is, how can we strengthen that capacity not only for individuals, but on a collective level? And like probably many of you, and like many people around the world, I share a sense that we live in a time of disruption where something is ending and dying and something else is wanting to be born. And what's ending and dying probably be a little more clear about. It has to do with a supersized me, with bigger is better, with special interest-driven decision-making that have led us to a state of organized irresponsibility in almost any kind of system. What's wanting to be born is a little less clear. It's kind of less, so it feels a little more vague, and yet it is something, it is a significant part of our experience for many people on this planet right now. And that's probably what brings us together here. And it has to do with connecting with a deeper level of our own awareness of who we are and where we can operate from as human beings, as entrepreneurs, as parents, and so on and so forth. So what does this social field, which is the sum total of the relationship that we enact as human beings, the social, economic, and all the other relationships, what does that really look like? And what kind of this moment of disruption that many people, the fact that we collectively create results that nobody wants in almost any kind of system today, what, you know, how can we make sense of that? And I would like to share kind of a simple drawing or image with you that you probably have seen many times, which is the iceberg model. Kind of there's like kind of this simple idea, there's like 10% of reality is visible above the waterline, and then kind of there's the other 90%, which are part of reality, the other 90% of the system that are less directly accessible to the eye. And what I have found helpful is to frame the disruption that currently, or the surface level of the disruption that currently is going on, in terms of these three divides, which is the ecological divide, the social economic divide, and the spiritual divide. And the ecological divide basically arises from a disconnect between self and nature and is manifesting in many forms that we are all very familiar with. And it's probably best summarized with the number 1.5. We currently operate a global economy that is using 1.5 planets. So we use 1.5 times the regeneration capacity of planet Earth, and that number keeps be going up. The social economic divide arises from the disconnect between self and other, and manifests in many forms of polarization, of conflict, of inequity, of poverty, of loss of structure and destruction. Of a general sense of that we live in a very, very fragile world or order that can be interrupted, disrupted any moment. So those two things are talked about a lot. But the third one, the spiritual divide, I think gets less attention. And yet it came up earlier this afternoon. So what I mean with spiritual divide is basically a disconnect between self and self. A disconnect between who I am today with who I could be tomorrow, between my current self and my emerging future self. And if, in my experience, if I experience that disconnect, it shows up in symptoms like energy loss, depression, burnout, and even suicide. In 2010, more people killed themselves than were killed by others through murder, war, and any kind of violent conflict, and natural disasters combined. So more people, in spite of all the violence going on, many more people kill themselves than are being killed through others. So that's a hidden dimension there. And yet, of course, it belongs to the picture. And picking up another distinction we heard this afternoon, reacting versus responding. What we do in society is we react against these systems. We have one or several ministry for each, one or several clusters of NGO focusing on all these issues, producing silo solutions. And only more recently, we started to realize that these are not three problems. They are three different manifestations of one and the same problem. But what then are these deeper drivers? And I don't want to go here into too much of detail, but of course, if we look below the waterline, there is a set of deeper systemic issues, deeper systemic disconnects that deserves to be explored and that need to be addressed. And what belongs to that is the disconnect between finite resources and the infinite growth imperative. What belongs to that is the disconnect between haves and have-nots. The disconnect between the financial economy and the real economy. And the disconnect between GDP and well-being and happiness. As many of you probably know, for developed countries, more GDP does not translate into more well-being. So if that's the case, if we are producing more, consuming more and more busy, but our well-being, our happiness, is not going up. So if that's the case, then the question is, what then is it? So what could be alternative indicators for measuring economic progress? So there are all these things, and I could go through all of them, and before the dawn, you will be all depressed. And that is actually, those are important questions. What you usually see is that different people that focus on one of these issues, for example, the financial and the real economy, they tend to come up with approaches which is, it's just all about this one. If we solve this one, if we just solve the money issue, then everything will be fine. And so that applies to all of these areas. So, and yet, I think more recently, we become aware it's a whole set of acupuncture points that needs to be addressed. And the real question is, what is it that drives, that makes us reenacting all these symptoms at the top level and all these systemic disconnects on the next level. What are the real root issues that we needed to address in order to respond, but not to react to this situation at the level of source? And I believe that probably the most important root issue for all of this is originating right between our ears. And it has to do with the quality of our thinking, with the quality of how we attend to and make sense of the economic relationship, the quality of economic thought. And when we look at the evolution of economic thought, that is basically the rationale, how we design all these, that's kind of, that provides the rationale, how we design all these institutions that more and more create these disconnects. When we look at that, and when we look at the evolution of the modern economy, I'm not putting everyone to sleep here. It's just kind of 2 minutes for 300 years of economic history. So, what is the modern economy? It's an economy that's based on the division of labor. And when we have this division of labor, the question is, okay, how do we stitch this whole thing together? What is coordinating all these different pieces to a whole? And throughout the last 200-300 years, we generated three responses. Number one, central coordination, right? Hierarchy and control. And that, you know, so we have seen economic systems driven by that. Mercantilism, but also kind of the socialistic planned economy is a version of that. And that's good because it creates some stability, but it's bad because it's lacking dynamism, it's lacking kind of entrepreneurial initiative, which then leads us to the next response, which is not centralized, but decentralized coordination. The rise of markets and competition, kind of market as a coordination mechanism, and the rise of the private sector, kind of the sector of entrepreneurship, you know, in addition to the public one. And that has led to an enormous amount of growth, to an enormous amount of wealth, and to an enormous amount of problems, of externalities in terms of environmental destruction, poverty, and so on and so forth, which then leads us to the third chapter, which has to do with the rise of a third sector, the social sector, kind of, you know, where we as civil society begin to organize around these issue areas and then come up with innovations that evolve the framework in which the market operates by, you know, standards for labor, social security, environmental protection, by the Federal Reserve System, kind of, which all of which basically do the same thing, which is suspending the market mechanism in areas where it's not leading to useful results. And that system, the 3.0 economy, has basically served many people well in the OECD countries over the 20th century. But as we enter this century, this system is hitting the wall. And that became nowhere more clear than the collapse of the climate talks in Copenhagen, and with Wall Street successfully intervening in Washington for an effective banking re-regulation after 2008. Right? Those are examples where you can see the real problem is not being addressed. There is like a collective paralysis happening. And what I believe is that we are at the cusp of, or we have the opportunity in this century to further evolve this economic system to a 4.0 economy that has to do with the three sectors not conflicting with each other, business, government, civil society, but co-creating with each other in order to innovate at the scale of the whole system. Not only innovations in small pockets, but really kind of evolve the whole system to address the real issues that we face at the beginning of this century. So what I'm saying here is that the evolution of the economy and the evolution of economic thought can be seen as an embodiment of an evolving consciousness, where we started with, you know, traditional awareness, stuff like loyalty, fitting in to existing forms, to ego system awareness and the 2.0 economy, which is kind of basically what we are still teaching until today in business schools, like where I am. And but then to a 3.0, to a stakeholder awareness, which is what really is happening in, you know, this is not happening in real reality. Kind of that's textbooks. The reality is this. It's in any kind of company, you need with your key stakeholders, right? You need to develop these relationships. You're dependent on evolving these relationships to be effective, to getting your job done. And that's the reality we have today. But we are not solving the big issues. And for that, we need to evolve that to an ecosystem awareness, by which I mean an awareness that is focusing on the well-beings of all. Of myself, yes. Of my direct stakeholders, yes. But also on the well-being of all, including the most marginalized and including the whole. And in fact, I believe that, so I have done projects in education, in sustainability, in health, in business, in other areas. And from my point of view, in all these systems, leaders face the same fundamental challenge, which is to move, and that's what I believe is the number one leadership challenge today across all systems, which is to move complex stakeholder systems that by and large today operate on a silo view, on ego system awareness, and to shift how they operate to a more co-creative way that is based on an ecosystem awareness, which is an awareness that is taking into account my own view, my own piece, but also the impact I am having on all the other stakeholders. And the question, of course, is what does it take to move a stakeholder system from ego to eco? And what it takes in our experience, and that's what I have been experiencing with, that has been my main job the last maybe 10, 15 years. And what we learned in all these experiments is what it takes is a journey. A journey that is moving this stakeholder group, kind of with very diverse interests and with very diverse backgrounds, through a process of observe, 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 really total immersion into all the different facets of the system, walking in the shoes of the most marginalized members in that system, walking in the shoes of others, seeing the system through their eyes. Retreat and reflect, allow the inner knowing to emerge, kind of cultivating the access to our deeper sources of knowing, both as individuals, but also as communities. And then number three, went from this kind of deep reflection and contemplation, a spark or two are emerging or ideas are showing up, explore them by doing. Act in an instant, kind of as a way of exploring the future by doing, by rapid cycle prototyping. So that's one thing that I learned. The other thing that I learned is this. This process in diverse, conflictual, multi-stakeholder settings only works if we cultivate the interior condition from which we operate. And here's the moment kind of when I realized that. It was an interview with another practitioner, Bill O'Brien, and here is how he summed up his many years of transformational leadership experience. He said, the success of an intervention depends on the interior condition of the intervener. So what he is saying is the success of what I do not only depends on the process that I apply, but on the inner place from that I operate, on the quality of attention and intention that I bring to a situation, on the quality of presence with that I show up in my work, in my life. And so when I first heard that, I thought, well, we know everything about what innovators and leaders do and how they do it, but what really do we know about kind of this inner place? And I became really intrigued about exploring that. And what emerged from that is a map that basically is differentiating between three different aspects or layers of that inner place: the open mind, the open heart, and the open will, which implicitly all were referenced, at least the first two were referenced earlier this afternoon. What I mean with open mind is the capacity to suspend our habits of thought. Remember kind of when we heard the inner voice, the inner chattering, kind of to suspending that and actually listen to what somebody is telling you. What I mean with open heart is the capacity to redirect, to look at a problem through the eyes of another. And what I mean with open will is the capacity to let go and let come. I would like to share with you an example where kind of I want to kind of demonstrate that with a little video clip and kind of tap into your feedback on that, where we see a leader leading by, connecting with these different dimensions, kind of by where we see a leader leading through listening. And what I mean with that is we see a leader leading through shifting the inner place. From that, my listening is being originated. And to set the stage for that, I want to differentiate four different levels of listening that you all are very familiar with. So the first one is what already we heard, kind of it's this inner voice, right? Which is, we are not listening. We are listening to that inner voice. And our attention is limited by what we already know, by our experience of the past. I see what I know. And the outcome here is that I reconfirm, exactly what I expected to see, what I already knew. And so if this circle is the boundary of my system, let's say my cognitive system, which is, the sum total of my concepts, of what I know and what I have experienced in the past, then this first type of listening is that I'm listening from the center of my own prison. I'm in a closed room, all the curtains are down, all the windows are closed. I cannot see what's going on outside in the real world. All I see is the mental frames that I'm projecting onto the wall. It's like your slides. It doesn't mean that your slides are good or bad or in touch or out of sync with what's going on in reality, but it's just your slides. It's not what actually is going on. You see what you know. And then the second one is factual listening, access your open mind, paying attention to what's different. And the outcome here is disconfirming new data. Kind of that's what good science is. Let the data talk to you. Notice what is different and unexpected. It's like you get up, you go to the window, you push away the curtain, and you watch what's going on outside. You see something that's unexpected. But then all of us moving kind of with, working in the complex socioeconomic relationships today, that's not good enough. There are two more. The third one is empathic listening, which is basically listening by accessing your empathy, your open heart. And the outcome is that you see the situation through the eyes of another. So here's what it is. The place from where your listening is happening shifts to the place where the other person is speaking from. And that literally happens. So if you how would you notice that you're operating from here? You forget your own agenda. You forget your own, blah, blah, blah. And you begin to attend to the situation through the eyes, through the experience, kind of from the place from where that other person is speaking from. So now I would like to, share, in a moment I would like to share with you kind of the clip that is demonstrating that. The fourth level is this. Open will basically means to connect to, an emerging future possibility that hasn't quite manifested yet. Think about a great coach. Right? A great coach, when I share my situation and my suffering and what's working and not, a great coach, a great educator, is not just empathizing with me, but is listening to me from a place where she's attending to my highest future potential, where she sees who I could be tomorrow. And that's what great leaders, what great educators do. So that's the fourth level. And now I want to show this three-minute clip. And it's a clip from 1990. In the center here, you see Zubin Mehta, one of the greatest conductors of our time. To his left, Placido Domingo, one of the greatest tenors. And so a huge orchestra, actually composed of two different orchestras that performed together the first time this night. And some of you may, if you, as you watch these 3 minutes, put yourself into the shoes of the conductor, okay? So he has this newly merged organization that some of you may be familiar with, that kind of dynamic. He has this superstar, someone who is more equal than anyone else, and he needs to handle that dynamic. And then he has a huge audience in his back, and all these forces are pulling him in different directions. His job is to pull all these diverging forces together in a moment of peak performance.
No puede ser esa mujer escuela. No puede ser una mujer malvada. En su mirar, como una luz singular, he visto esa mujer, es una desventurada. No puede ser una vulgar sirena. Las horas de mi vida no puede ser porque la vi rezar, porque la vi querer, porque la vi llorar. Los me lloran, no saben mentir, las malas mujeres no miran así, temblando en sus ojos, dos lágrimas vi, y arriba ilusión.
So for a brief moment, take in and stay with what you just saw. What was it that you observed? What was the shift that you noticed? What did you actually observe? What changed? So having, we don't have the time now to go a lot into detail there, but having that, having debriefed that moment here with that clip with many groups, kind of here like two or three things that almost everyone is pointing out. Number one, the end was very different than the beginning. So some way midway, something happened. So first it was kind of more this, and then towards the end you can see the movement is synchronized, the breathing is synchronized. It's no longer two individuals interacting. It is kind of one creative field that's manifesting through not only both of them, but all of them. So that's kind of a first observation. And a second one is that there is, so when is the question actually, and I'm going to show the last 30 seconds and a few moments again, so you can verify everything with your own observation. But how did that shift actually happen? And the reason why I love this clip is because I believe, so I'm not a musician, I actually don't really know what's going on here. But I have been, I have seen shifts like that in groups many times. And what I love about this clip is that I believe the conductor, with his gestures, he's embodying an inner movement you have to create as a member in a group, as a facilitator, as you know, someone who is holding the space for a shift like that, that makes it very accessible. So first, you know, he is this, right? So that's like kind of the normal ways how we operate. And then remember, kind of at some point, and you will see it in a few moments again, he's turning around, opening the arms, and giving all the attention to Placido. So he has opened the arms. So it's not only you see in that moment the emotional connection building up. It's not only here. Kind of you see how that connection, the heart-to-heart connection, is building up. And then, I don't know whether you remember what happens, kind of that's this, right? So where this boundary between each other is collapsing. So he's here. And I don't know whether you remember what happened next. Shortly after, this happens. He's dropping the baton. Now, think about that. As a conductor, I get my paycheck for doing this. Dropping the baton as a conductor on stage is a radical statement. And it's a statement that says it's not about me. It's not about me being the superstar. It's also, it's about, I don't know whether he would say it's about you, but it's about that emerging moment of music that was just about to be born through Placido. And then, so what he does is, and that's what we know from facilitating these shifts. You have, as a leader, you have to remove yourself from the center. So he is removing himself from the center. And what he's doing is he's holding the space, holding the space. Any one of us who ever participated in a creative process, what is it that happens first? Nothing. Nothing happens because the creative moment is arriving at its own schedule. So he's holding the space, nothing happens. He's holding the space. So as a professional, he keeps, so all the attention is on that emerging moment of music. He's holding the space, and then you see how that emerging moment of music is beginning to land onto Placido, kind of is beginning to emerge through him, and then you see the baton goes back up. alerting the orchestra. Kind of, it's about time, it's about time. And then, before it actually happens, the baton goes back up and he takes the entire orchestra into a collective delivery of that emerging moment of music. That is not downloading, it's not factual, it's also not empathy. It is the fourth way, it's the fourth structure of attention, how we as human beings can connect with reality and with each other. And it's about turning yourself into an instrument, into a vehicle for something that isn't quite there yet to be born. And that's what I call... That's where the word ends and where the music begins.
Viva luz de mi ilusión Qué piadosa con mi amor Porque no sé fingir Porque no sé callar Porque no sé
So let me quickly reflect on that, on some of the principles, and then apply them to the collective evolution of social fields with a few examples that I will quickly mention. So number one, what we saw is that a principle that I would call form follows consciousness. So I pay attention this way, therefore it emerges that way. The quality of my attention is shaping, is holding the space for a pathway how reality can unfold. And that's what we just saw. Then number two is, okay, if that is true, how can we deepen, how can we build that capacity to move beyond downloading same old, same old? And so number two is it takes a process of going through the observe, you know, connecting with the outside, connecting with what's emerging from within, and then operating from what's emerging from the now, the prototyping. Number three, to do that well requires us to hone, to cultivate, to tune the three inner instruments of knowing. The open mind, the open heart, and the open will. Number four, at the foundation of all of that, are two root questions of creativity, which are, who is myself, and what is my work? And who is myself, I'm referring to the capital S self, which is my highest future possibility, not my ego, kind of, but my highest future possibility. And what is my work, the capital W work is, what is kind of my sense of purpose, my sense of calling? What is it I'm here for? Five, why is this the road less traveled? Because the moment we commit ourselves to going on that journey, we are facing three inner enemies or sources of resistance. The voice of judgment, already referenced several times today. The voice of cynicism, not less powerful. And, of course, the voice of fear. And these three forces are shutting down the capacity of the open mind, the open heart, the open will. And then lastly, for us who are shaping, who are trying to do this kind of work that we saw in the clip, in the context of the social field, here is what we need to do. We need to do it, number one, as individuals, as we saw in the evolution of listening, from downloading to factual to empathic. You see the arms going up and the generative, kind of where he's dropping the baton. But at the same time, we also need this to be applied to the collective field in terms of evolving the way we create reality through our conversations, from downloading, same old, how are you, I'm fine, kind of just conforming with existing forms, debate, speaking your mind, but being stuck in your own viewpoint, kind of really being unable to move beyond your own viewpoint, dialogue, which is really the capacity of a system to see itself, to see yourself as part of the whole, kind of, and from the whole. So collective creativity that we saw a little bit indicated. And then the same evolution, kind of, in most of the projects we work on, and most of us work on, needs to be applied to the institutional level. The evolution of companies, of governments, of NGOs, from centralized to decentralized, to networked, to ecosystem-based, which is kind of a little bit what was indicated kind of when Andy was talking. And all of that takes place in the larger transformation of capitalism through these four stages of economic evolution that I mentioned before, and where the fourth one really is about the birth of awareness-based collective action, kind of something that I think can be a coordination mechanism that we see emerging in various parts of the world right now. What does that look like? This is a process in Africa, transforming, focusing on maternal health, bringing together all these stakeholders, setting an intention, what they wanted to create in this crisis that they face, then co-sensing, you know, walking in the shoes of all the different users of the system, deep reflection, connecting it with my journey, with our journey, kind of I am the system, really connecting, deepening the ownership, generating ideas that are explored through doing, and then kind of taking the best parts of it and bringing it out throughout the system. So what is that? So if you look at this, this is really about people in the end, helping to evolve how people relate to each other, to the system, and to themselves. So it's basically from seeing the system as something out there, something they are doing to us, towards seeing yourself as being part of the system. These moments, these aha moments, we, among others, kind of support with something we call social presencing theater, which is a blend between constellation work, mindfulness, and dialogue. Kind of really, it's about mapping, a 4D mapping of in stage one, the current reality in a system. You see all these. So this is the biggest Chinese bank, which also happens to be the biggest bank and the biggest company in the world last year. And they reenact. So this is about, you know, reinventing themselves in the face of big data, and how they reinvent their relationships to each other, to the customer, to the communities, all of that. That's kind of, it's being explored this way. This is with Alibaba on ecosystem management, the same process, but here you see it in objects on the ground. Here they enact that with their bodies, right? And here it's kind of, and you see all these different groups, kind of all these are the leadership teams of the different business units of the Alibaba group, and they map the current system and how it can evolve, and then kind of share that in the larger ecosystem with each other. This is a strategy reinvention process that works kind of through of one of the most sustainable, very small, kind of 100% sustainable investment banks in Europe, sensing, you know, going a lot on learning journeys. That's the first emphasis. So really listening, reaching out to all the larger system where banking is today being reinvented outside the conventional banking system. Then integrating that with a scenario method, kind of to really explore different ways how the larger, what are these larger forces that reshape the context of business, and what are the possibilities how this story could unfold. but then connecting that with deeper mindfulness practices. So for example, one of the questions most influential was, if name of the company kind of was a living being that could talk to you, what would it say? How would it speak to you? So it's like using kind of reflective, like journaling practices to tap into what really is essential kind of about the larger and the deeper purpose kind of that's really at the core of a social mission-driven enterprise that we are a part of. So who are we and who do we want to be as the foundation of that? And then, of course, you know, exploring, connecting other folks with that. Global Wellbeing and G&H Lab. Bringing together leaders from business, government, civil society from North America, Brazil, you know, Asia, Europe, on a journey where they take a deep dive into how how we need to innovate beyond GDP, how we can come up with other metrics to measure and create well-being in our economies, and then implementing them. Tomorrow, kind of one of them, the participants here from the US, was the governor of Oregon, who then, and a part of his team, who then became very instrumental of pushing the concept of GPI, Genuine Progress Indicator, which is, you could say, a US version of G&H, into from 5 to now 20 states where that's being prepared to be implemented. And on the business side, we had very interesting experiments around linking the power of entrepreneurship with the power of the open heart, kind of on compassionate entrepreneurship. And we will hear probably Eileen Fisher tomorrow talking about that, kind of who has been developing probably our most significant kind of living example here on the business side. Let me switch over this and just kind of as a last point, how to make all of this accessible to a global movement at a price point of zero. And that's, of course, the disruption that's currently going on in education, as you know, kind of MOOCs, massive open online course, everything on the internet. That's where we at MIT try to be really an innovator for free. Great success, but also great problems, because all the learning is very flat. It's really just transfer of technical knowledge. It has not been implemented for profound, transformative learning environments that we talk about here. And that's kind of the experiment of the ULAB MOOC that is linking mindfulness practice with local action learning with using Google Hangout, virtual deep coaching, deep listening coaching groups across cultures, live sessions where the whole global community is coming together during the same hour, and a set of regional hubs where the community can participate and connect with each other on site. So education as global movement building around linking science, spirituality, and social change. That's it.